Again, we are at the last message for the day, and we will continue next week, Thursday. And our particular subject this afternoon is entitled, What is Truth? I'm going to invite you to kneel with me as far as you're able, and pray for a special endowment of the Holy Spirit. We're going to need him for this session, and let's ask for his presence. Father, we want to commit this time to you, Lord. And Father, we are truly asking now for you to do something for humanity that is impossible. Souls are at stake, Lord. We're in the last moments of this earth's history. I believe that the stone is about to strike and smite the feet of that statue. And we need thorough conversion. There's no human being that can convert a heart. So I pray that you will speak to me, speak through me, to your people, and I pray that we will all be in unison to say, Lord, we're going to follow all that you say. For we ask in Jesus' name. Amen. There's a pastor by the name of Adrian Rogers that penned these words, it is better to be divided by truth than to be united in error. Again, our subject is entitled, What is Truth? He says, it is better to speak the truth that hurts and then heals than falsehood that comforts and then kills. Let me tell you something, friend. It is not love and it is not friendship if we fail to declare the whole counsel of God. It is better to be hated for telling the truth than to be loved for telling a lie. It is better to stand alone with the truth than to be wrong with a multitude. He's simply echoing the words of Paul. In the book of Acts chapter 20, Paul says, I am free from the blood of all men, for I have not shunned to declare unto you the whole counsel of God. So Paul says, I have done my part, and now I turn it over to the people. Now, Winston Churchill also once said, most people sometime in their life stumble across truth. Most jump up, brush themselves off, and hurry on about their business as if nothing had happened. I'm praying that's not the experience that we have here today. Now, go with me, your Bible, to the book of Ezekiel, chapter 33. Ezekiel, chapter 33. And I want you to notice what the Bible says in the book of Ezekiel, chapter 33. And picking up in verse 30. Ezekiel chapter 33. And let's notice what the Bible says, picking up in verse 30. The Bible says, also thou son of man, the children of thy people still are talking against thee by the walls and in the doors of thy house, and speaking one to another, everyone to his brother, saying, come, I pray you, and hear what is the word of the Lord that cometh from the Lord. And they come unto thee as the people cometh. And they sit before thee as my people, and they hear thy words, but they will not do them, for with their mouth they show much love, but their hearts goeth after their covetousness. In other words, Ezekiel says, they're willing to come to church. They're willing to sit down. They're willing to hear. In fact, they're willing to say, that was the truth. But then he says, they will not do them. Can I get some more volume on the mic, please? Then he said, they will not do them. Now, As we continue in verse 32, the Bible says, "And lo, thou art unto them a very lovely song of one that that hath a pleasant voice and can play well on an instrument. For they hear thy words, but they do them not." What am I saying, my brothers and sisters? We have been studying for almost 3 weeks. We have heard a lot of things. We have seen a lot of things. I've heard testimonies after testimonies. There's some that were here that were excited that's no longer coming. And there's some that's still coming that's excited but still have not decided. And my goal is not for us to come and say, that was a powerful message. If the message does not transform into power in your life to help you to overcome those sins that are overpowering you. There comes a time that when you hear the truth, a decision must be made on the truth. Are you with me so far? Therefore, we must make these choices while there's opportunity. I was just doing a series of meetings a couple of months ago. In fact, it's transpiring for about a year. I've been going back and forth in South Georgia, a town called Albany. And I've been doing series after series there. And I remember there's a particular family that came out to the meetings. And how they came was that one of the sons were strung out on some hard drugs. And they started coming and their lives were transformed. I presented some of the things that we presented here. And they made decisions. They made decisions that by God's grace, I'm going to keep the Sabbath. By God's grace, I'm going to make changes on my health. By God's grace, I'm going to follow the message of the sanctuary. And they made all these changes. And then after we left, one by one, all three of them trickled down and began to make poor choices in their lives again, not following any of the counsel that were followed, that were given. Then I got a call suddenly about a couple of months back saying that the mother suddenly had a heart attack and passed away. Unfortunate news. And I'm just praying that she was able to make a conscientious choice before that time happened. And then, strange enough, a couple of weeks or months after that, I got another call that the sister also was found dead in her sleep in the morning. And this just happened quite a few months back. And now the guy that was struggling with the drugs and so on and so forth, he's still going through struggles, but he texts me a couple of weeks ago and says, "Look, I fully now want to surrender my life to God. I'm giving up. I see so many things happening around me, and I fully want to surrender." Now, my brothers and sisters, what am I saying? Don't let the hearse take you to church. Don't let the hearse be the determining factor of whether or not we are in church. Because when the hearse takes you, people are saying a lot of good things about you, but you cannot hear it. In fact, the Bible says, "What profit is there in my blood when I go down to the pit? Shall the dust praise thee? Shall it declare thy truth?" What is God saying? When you are alive and well and you can function full in your mind, when truth is presented to you, that is the time that we're supposed to make a decision for the truth. How does someone put themselves in that position? Go with me your Bibles to the book of 2 Thessalonians. 2 Thessalonians. Again, our subject is entitled, "What is Truth?" Now, I'm anxious for us to get this today, my brothers and sisters. Very anxious. 2 Thessalonians chapter 10. What puts a person in a position where they can hear the truth but not respond? 2 Thessalonians chapter 2, verse 10, the Bible says, "And with all deceivableness of unrighteousness in them that perish, because they receive not the love of the truth that they might be saved. And for this cause, God shall send them strong delusion, and they should believe a lie, that they all might be damned who believe not the truth, but had pleasure in unrighteousness." God is saying, if you hear the truth, but you're not loving the truth, and you're still having pleasure in unrighteousness, eventually you're going to be deceived. And as a result, you will be damned. Because you love not the truth and have pleasure in unrighteousness. My brothers and sisters, my ultimate goal, my burden, what my prayer at night before I go to bed and in the morning when I wake up is that we'll not just hear the truth, say this is good information, without that good information leading to transformation. Now, there comes a point in life where we need to make decisions on the truth. What's our subject? What is truth? Go with me your Bible to the book of 1 Kings chapter 18. 1 Kings chapter 18. You remember the prophet Elijah, wonderful, powerful prophet, is on Mount Carmel and he shows the miracles of God. The people are caught up in Baal worship and false worship. And as a result, God raised up Elijah to bring their minds back. And God worked miracle after miracle after miracle and showed them that he's a true God on Mount Carmel. And now Elijah says, now you see the hand of God. You saw that all of the Baal and the pagan worshipers, they could do nothing. You have seen the power of God. And now Elijah said, now is a time to decide. Watch what it says in verse 21. And Elijah came unto all the people and said, how long halt ye between two opinions? The Lord be God, follow him. But if Baal, then follow him. And I want you to notice, the Bible said, and the people answered him not a word, my brothers and sisters. And let me say this, no answer is an answer. The Bible says, how long halt ye between how many? Two opinions. If God, then serve God. If Baal, then serve Baal. The Bible says, no man can serve how many? Two masters. God says, if you're not with me, then you are against me. There's no spiritual Switzerland in the Christian walk. If you do not choose God, then by default you have chosen the devil, my friends. And God says, how long halt ye between two opinions? They answered not a word, but they gave an answer. They should have said, Lord, I see the power. I see the miracle. And Lord, I'm not feeling it right now, but I'm praying, Lord, take my heart because I cannot give it. I see the power of God moving, but even though I'm not in a position right now in my mind to make a decision, I'm praying, Lord, help me. That man came to Christ and Christ says, do you believe? He says, no, Lord, but I want you to help my unbelief. Sometimes we have to make some kind of choice. Even if we can't make the full choice and fully surrender at the moment, we must say, Lord, I need help to surrender, my friends. How long haughty between the two opinions? Now, it says, even more than God abhors, that word means hates infidelity. It goes on to say, he abhors indifference. In other words, God says, make a choice. If you're not with me, you're against me. Don't try to stand in spiritual Switzerland and say, I'm not making a choice, because you are making a choice, my friends. And that's why God hates the Laodiceans. I know thy works, that thou art neither cold nor hot. God says, I would thou wert cold or hot. So then because thou art lukewarm and neither cold nor hot, in other words, because you have not made a decision, God says, I will spew thee out of my mouth. God does not like lukewarm Christians, my friends. God says, make a choice. Now, what is truth is our subject. Go with me your Bible to the book of John chapter 18. John chapter 18, as we embark upon the subject, which is entitled, what is truth? John chapter 18. I want you to notice what the Bible says in John chapter 18, picking up in verse 28. The innocent Jesus is brought before Pilate. The Bible says in John chapter 18 and verse 28, are we there together? Then led they Jesus from Caiaphas into the hall of judgment. And it was early. And they themselves went not into the judgment hall, lest they should be defiled, but that they might eat the Passover. Pilate then went out unto them and said, what accusation bring ye against this man? They answered and said unto him, if he were not a malefactor, we would not have delivered him up unto thee. So in other words, they cannot find any fault with Jesus. But the only thing they said is if something wasn't wrong, we wouldn't have brought him. And then Pilate said, take him and judge him according to your law. The Jews therefore said unto them, it is not lawful for us to put a man to death. We can't do it, but we're going to bring it to you so that you can do it. What hypocrites, my friends. That the saying of Jesus might be fulfilled, which he spake, signifying what death he should die. Then Pilate entered into the judgment hall again, and called Jesus, and said unto him, art thou the king of the Jews? Jesus answered him, saith, thou this thing of thyself, or did others tell it of thee, of me? Verse 35, Pilate answered and said, am I a Jew? Thine own nation and the chief priests have delivered thee unto me. What hadst thou done? Jesus answered, my kingdom is not of this world. If my kingdom were of this world, then would my servants fight, but I should not be delivered to the Jews. But now is my kingdom not from thence. Pilate therefore said unto him, art thou a king? Jesus answered, thou sayest that I am king. To this end was I born, and for this cause came I into the world, that I should bear witness unto the, talk to me, the truth. Everyone that is of the truth heareth my voice. What's our subject? What is truth? Verse 38. Pilate saith unto him, say it with me, my brothers and sisters, what is truth? And when he had said this, he went out again unto the Jews and saith unto him, I find in him no fault at all. So the question is, what is truth? What is truth? Now, we have been studying for 3 weeks, my brothers and sisters, and I want to answer Pilate's question on all of our behalves. The question is, what is truth, my friends? When you go to the Bible in the book of John, chapter 17 and verse 17, the Bible says, sanctify them through thy word. And what did it say? Thy word is truth, my brothers and sisters. I'm going to answer Pilate's question, and I'm going to say that the word of God is truth. And my question is this, have we used the word of God for these last 3 weeks? Yes or no? So we have given you the truth. We're answering Pilate's question on your behalf. What is truth? The word of God is truth, my brothers and sisters. What is truth? Let's look to answer this question some more. What is truth? Psalm 119. Let's notice what the Bible says in Psalm 119. And let's notice what the Bible says. Psalm 119. We're looking to answer Pilate's question. He asks a question, what is truth? And we're going to answer that question this evening. Psalm 119. And notice what the Bible says in Psalm 119, verse 142. The Bible says, thy righteousness is an everlasting righteousness, and thy law is the truth, my friends. Go to 151. The Bible says, thou art near, O Lord, and all thy commandments are truth. Did we talk about the commandments of God in these last 3 weeks, my brothers and sisters? In other words, we have told you the truth. We have used the word of God. The Bible says, thy word is truth. We have talked about the law of God. The Bible says, thy commandments is truth. And my question is, Pilate asked the question, what is truth? And if we have the question, what is truth? That question is being answered today. The word of God is truth. The law of God is truth. We presented the word and we presented the law. In other words, we have given you the truth. Are you listening to me today, my friends? What is truth? Go with me in your Bible to the book of Daniel, chapter 8. Daniel, chapter 8. The question is, what is truth? Daniel, chapter 8. I want you to notice what the Bible says in the book of Daniel, chapter 8, verse 11 and verse 12. The Bible says, yea, he magnified himself, even to the prince of the hosts, And by him the daily sacrifice was taken away, and the place of his, what's the next word? Sanctuary was cast to the ground. Verse 12. And an host was given him against the daily sacrifice by reason of the transgression. And what did he do? And he cast the truth to the ground and practiced and prospered. In other words, the Bible is saying the sanctuary is the truth. Did we talk about the sanctuary, my brothers and sisters? We've talked about the Word of God. We've talked about the law of God. We've talked about the sanctuary. In other words, we have told you the truth. So what's the answer to Pilate's question? The Word of God is truth. The law of God is truth. And the sanctuary is the truth. And that means we have all sat here and heard truth from the Word of God. And the question is, what will we do with the truth, my friends? All right. What else is truth? John 16 and verse 13. John 16, 13. Let's notice what the Bible says. John 16 and verse 13. The Bible says in John 16 and verse 13, howbeit, when he, the Spirit of what? Of truth is come, he will guide you into all truth, for he shall not speak of himself, but whatsoever he shall speak, that shall he speak, and he will show you things to come. In other words, the Bible is saying the Holy Spirit is the truth. Not one time did I not get on my knees and ask for the Holy Spirit's presence to be with us before we open up the Word of God, before we talked about the law of God, before we talked about the sanctuary of God. We always ask for the guidance of the Holy Spirit, and the Bible said that the Spirit of God is the truth, my friends. In other words, we have been presented with the truth. My question is, what will we do with the truth? Now, one of the worst things that humanity could do is grieve the Holy Spirit. Let's notice how this is done. Matthew chapter 12. Matthew chapter 12. Let's notice what the Bible says in the book of Matthew chapter 12, verses 30 through 32. Matthew 12, verse 30 through verse 32. The Bible says in Matthew chapter 12 and verse 30. Are we there together? He that is not with me is against me. And he that gathereth not with me scattereth abroad. Wherefore I say unto you, all manner of sin and blasphemy shall be forgiven unto men, but the blasphemy against the Holy Ghost shall not be forgiven unto men. And whosoever speaketh the word against the Son of Man, it shall be forgiven him, but whosoever speaketh against the Holy Ghost, it shall not be forgiven him, neither in this world, neither in the world to come. When truth is presented and truth is rejected, just like Saul, just like Judas, who stood in the midst of truth and rejected the truth, the Bible says that both of these men, they grieved the Spirit of God, and now they died, and they will be in a second resurrection. And the Bible says that's the resurrection that we don't want to be in, because the Bible says when they come up, fire comes down from God out of heaven and devours them. What am I saying? It is a dangerous thing to resist the Spirit when the Spirit has presented to you the truth. When you feel that little prick in your heart and you're trying to decide if I'm going to go all the way with Jesus, when you feel that prick in your heart and you're feeling that you want to give up this sins in your life, you want to give up those pornography, you want to give up those TV programs, you want to give up those ungodly music, you want to give up those video games, you want to give up the lustful eye, you want to give up the lust of the flesh, you want to give up the provocative dress, you want to give up all these things, that voice that speaks to you, my brothers and sisters, is the Spirit of truth. And when we reject the Spirit long enough, the Bible says it is possible that we can grieve the Spirit of God. I say that we should respond to the Spirit of truth. What do you say, my friends? All right. There's another truth. Jesus says in John chapter 14 and verse 6, I am the way and the truth and the life. Have we talked about Jesus since we've been here, my friends? Every message, including health, we failed not to uplift Christ and him crucified. In other words, we presented the Word of God, which is truth. We presented the law of God, which is truth. We presented a sanctuary of God, which is truth. We talked about the spirit of truth. And we talked about Jesus, who is the way and the truth on the life. In other words, in every message, we have received the truth. So in answer to Pilate's question, what is truth? We see very clearly from the Word of God, my friends, we have all received the truth. What is truth, my friends? Or should I say, what is the truth to us? Now, the question is this. What did Pilate do with the truth? So it's one thing to hear the truth, one thing to receive the truth, but the question is, what is done with the truth that you have received? What did Pilate do with the truth? Go back with me to the book of John. What did Pilate do with the truth? Let's notice what the Bible says in the book of John, chapter 18. What did Pilate do with the truth? Let's notice what the Bible says in the book of John, chapter 18, picking up in verse 38. We're going to pick back where we left off, right back where we left off, John 18 and verse 38. The Bible said, Pilate saith unto him, what's those three words? What is truth? And when they had said this, he went out again unto the Jews and saith unto them, I find what? In him no fault. Pilate says, I see that this man is a spotless. I see that man is the Son of God. In fact, I even really received a revelation through my wife, who does not even believe in a God, that this man should be left alone. We can look at that. And Pilate says, I find no fault in him. My question for us, my friends, do we find any fault in Jesus? In fact, hold John. Let's go to Jeremiah chapter 2. Hold John 18. Let's go to Jeremiah chapter 2 very quickly. Jeremiah chapter 2. Don't lose John. We're going to go right back to John. But my question is, do we find any fault in Jesus? Do we find any fault with the Word of God? Do we find any fault with the sanctuary? Do we find any fault with the Holy Spirit? Do we find any fault with any of these things, my friends? The question is, what is truth to us? Jeremiah chapter 2. Notice what the Bible says. Starting in verse 2. The Bible says, go and cry in the ears of Jerusalem, saying, thus saith the Lord, I remember thee in the kindness of thy youth, the love of thy espousals, when thou wentest after me in the wilderness, in a land where there was not sown. Verse 3, Israel was holiness unto me. God says, you was holiness to me, but you left me. You used to walk with God, but you left me, God is saying. He said, you was holiness to me. He says, you were the first fruit of mine increase, and all that devour him shall be offended of evil. Verse 5, thus said the Lord, what iniquity have your fathers found in me, that they are gone far from me, and have walked after vanity, and are become vain? God is saying, my friends, have you found anything wrong with me? Have I wronged you in any way? God is saying, tell me what I've done wrong to you while you're serving the devil instead of me. God says, tell me what fault you find in me. And even in the midst of their apostasy, notice what the Bible says in verse 9. God says, wherefore I will yet plead, even though you're apostatizing and walking away from me, and you're walking away from the truth, God says, I'll still plead with you, saith the Lord. And with your children's children will I plead. Praise God that he's still pleading for us, my friends. Going back to John. I find no fault with the man. Verse 39. But we have a custom that I should release unto you one of the Passover, one at the Passover. Will ye therefore that I release unto you the King of the Jews? Then cry they all again, saying, not this man, but Barabbas. In other words, don't give me the spotless Lamb of God. Don't give me the man that I can find no fault with. I'd rather you release a murderer, a thief, and a robber. Don't give me Jesus, my friend. And unfortunately, the world today is still choosing Barabbas. They cried all again, saying, not this man, but Barabbas, not Barabbas. Now, Barabbas was a robber. Chapter 19, verse 1. Then Pilate therefore took Jesus and scourged him. Spotless. Nothing wrong with Jesus. Scourged him. And the soldiers planted a crown of thorns and put on his head, and they put it on him a purple robe, and said, "Hail, King of the Jews!" And they smote him with their hands. Pilate therefore went forth again and saith unto them, "Behold, I bring forth to you, that ye may know that I find no fault with him." Pilate says, he's been scourged, but I'm just letting you know, I still find no fault with him. What did he do? He still compromised, my friends. Verse 5. Then came forth Jesus wearing the crown of thorns and the purple robe. And Pilate saith unto them, "Behold the man." When the chief priests, therefore, and officers saw him, they cried out, saying, "Crucify him! Crucify him!" Pilate saith unto them, "Take ye him and crucify him, for I find no fault with him." They find no fault with the truth, but guess what? They still crucify the truth, my friends. We've heard the word of God. We've heard about the sanctuary. We heard about the law of God. We heard about the Holy Spirit. We've heard about Jesus. And I can say that we can say we find no fault with it. But my question is, are we going to follow the truth? Are we going to adhere to the truth? Or will we crucify the truth as did Pilate, my friends? Pilate saw the truth, but he took the truth. And he crucified the truth. What is truth? All the truths coming across. In the sanctuary, the lamb was slain. The commandments require a dying to self. And Jesus was crucified on the cross. All of the truths come with a cross. And there's three mistakes that Pilate made. How many mistakes? Now, I don't want us to make those same mistakes. So we're going to find out what they are. Amen? What are the three mistakes? Mistake number one, resisting the prompting of the Holy Spirit. What did he do? Resisted the promptings of the Holy Spirit. Go to Matthew chapter 27. Matthew chapter 27. And notice what the Bible says in Matthew 27, verse 19 and verse 20. The Holy Spirit spoke to Pilate with great clarity. Bible says, Matthew chapter 27, verse 19. When he was set down on the judgment seat, his wife sent unto him, saying, "Have thou nothing to do with that just man? For I have suffered many things this day in a dream because of him." God sent Pilate's wife a dream and gave Pilate a warning, says, "Look, I know what you're about to do. You're about to compromise the truth." And God says, "Don't do it. Through your paganistic wife, I'm going to send a warning. I'm going to send you a dream." And God is saying, "Pilate, don't do it." But, and that's all of our problem. I know that this is the truth, but I know that this act that I'm about to do is wrong, but. And let me say this, my friends. It does not matter what comes after that but. Anytime God gives you the truth, there's a but. Whatever comes after, it does not matter. Whatever comes after that but could be the means of you losing your soul. "Leave this man alone," the wife says. "But the chief priests and the elders persuaded the multitudes that they should ask Barabbas and destroy Jesus." And what happened? Pilate compromised the truth, my friends. Why? The word but. Whenever we're faced with the truth, leave that word but alone. That word but will get you in trouble. The Bible says, "Grieve not the Holy Spirit of God, whereby we are sealed unto the day of redemption." The Spirit spoke to Pilate in great clarity, but he was persuaded by others to make a wrong choice. Sometimes we hear the truth, we talk about certain things that we're supposed to take off, the ornaments and the jewelry and all these things, and we said, "I would take it off, but, I would change my dress, but, I would stop watching that thing, but, I would stop going to certain places, but." It does not what matter come what after the but. What are you doing? You're compromising the truth, my friends. Whenever the Word of God speaks with great clarity and you give a reason for not doing what God says, that's a but, and that's a but that will get you lost. Must be careful, my friends. Mistake number two, allowing distractions to keep you from the truth. Now, this is very imperative. And with that, I want you to go with me to the book of Luke. Luke chapter 14. And I want you to notice what the Bible says in the book of Luke chapter 14. Allowing distractions to keep you from the truth. Luke chapter 14. And let's notice what the Bible says, picking up in verse 16. Then said he unto them, a certain man made a great supper, and bade how many? Many. And sent his servant at supper time to say unto them that they were bidden, come, for all things are now ready. In other words, God is saying, I have prepared a marriage supper in heaven, and I've gone to prepare mansions for you, and I'm going to invite many. But listen to what happened. When God gave them the truth of the word, when God gave them the truth of the Holy Spirit, when God gave them the truth of Christ, when God gave them the truth of the sanctuary, when God gave them the truth of the Sabbath, when God gave them the truth of the commandments, what happened? The Bible says, and they all with one consent began to do what, saints? Make excuse. Dangerous, my friends. The first said unto him, I have bought a piece of ground, and I must needs to go and see it first. I pray thee, have me excused. In other words, God is saying that in the last days, this parable is speaking to the people of God, and many of them will make earthly possessions an excuse for following the truth. I have something that I have just bought, and I must utilize that first, take advantage of that first. And God says, that is an excuse, my friends. Earthly possessions. Another said, I have bought 5 yokes of oxen, and I go to prove them. I pray thee, have me excused. You know what oxen was? It was their money, their means of making money. It was their employment. So he says, I would serve God, I will follow the truth, but, remember, it doesn't matter what comes after the but my job will not give me the time off. But I work too many hours. But my job is so consuming that I cannot find time to study. But it does not matter, my friends. His job caused him to be lost. God says, come to my marriage supper. He says, wait, I have to take care of my oxen. I have to take care of my business. I would serve God, but now is not a good time. But, oh, my friends, be careful with those buts. What's the other one? Verse 20. And another said, I have married a wife. Therefore, I cannot come. In other words, the truth was presented in great clarity. They were invited to the marriage supper, and they said, I would serve God, but what would my son think? What would my daughter think? What would my husband think? What would my wife think? What would my grandmother think? I've been going to this particular church, and I've been doing these things my whole life. The question is, did you get the truth from those places, my friends? God says, when the truth comes, you make a choice. Leave earthly possessions alone. Leave the job alone. Leave the family member alone. God says, if you will come after me, you must deny yourself, take up your cross, and follow me. When the truth is presented, leave the buts alone, my friends. It continues. The Bible says in verse 21. So that servant came and showed his Lord these things. Then the master of the house, being angry, said to the servant, go out quickly into the streets and the lanes of the cities, and bring in hither the poor and the maimed and the halt and the blind. And the servant said, Lord, it is done as thou hast commanded, and yet there is room. And the Lord said to the servant, go out to the highways and hedges and compel them to come, that my house may be filled. God says, if you're not going to follow it, I'll get somebody else to do it. Praise God. Amen. God is not going to leave his house empty. There will be no empty mansions in heaven. Praise the Lord. But at the same time, it's sorrowful because we mentioned this morning that God did not consider heaven a place desiresome while we were lost. Now, notice what it says now in verse 33. In fact, let's look at 27 and onwards as well. 25. Let's just continue. And there went great multitudes with him, and turned and said unto him, if any man come to me and hath not, and hate not his father, mother, wife, children, brethren, sister, yea, his own life, Also, he cannot be my disciple. In other words, God is not saying to hate your parents or hate your wife or hate your brother. God is saying, if you're putting them before me, then you're not worthy to be my disciples. Why? Because I counted heaven. I put my entire heaven at peril when I came down to earth and gave my life. So I don't want to hear any excuses, God says. God says, I have given you the truth in the embodiment of my Son. And he was crucified on the cross. He died that you may live. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son. So God says, I'm not interested in the excuses. When I remove all your excuses, when Adam sinned, I came to Adam. I tried to save Adam. Just the same way I'm trying to save you. And praise God, Adam will be in the kingdom. Amen? Then he says, for which of you intended to build a house, sitteth not down first and count the what? The cost. Verse 33. The Bible says, so likewise, whosoever be of you that forsaketh not that he hath, all that he hath, he cannot be my disciple. God says, when the truth is presented, everything else around the truth should be forsaken. Don't let the job stop you. Don't let earthly possessions stop you. Don't let earthly relationships stop you. God says, let nothing get in the way of the truth. When you hear about the commandments of God, when you hear about the sanctuary of God, when you hear about Jesus the truth, when you hear the Holy Spirit pricking your heart, let nothing come in the way of the truth, my friends. And God is calling us for a decision on the truth. Mistake number three for Pilate: avoiding the right decision by compromise. Avoiding the right decision by compromise. Luke 23. Let's go back there. Luke 23. And notice what the Bible says in verse 3 through 7. Avoiding the right decision. The Bible says, when Pilate heard, in fact, let's start at verse 3. That was verse 6. And Pilate asked him, saying, art thou the king of the Jews? And he answered him and saith, thou sayest. Verse 4. Then said Pilate to the chief priests and to the people, I find no fault in this man. And they were the more fierce, saying, he stirreth up the people, teaching throughout all Jewry, beginning from Jerusalem to get to this place. Verse 6. When Pilate heard of Galilee, he asked whether the man were a Galilean. And as soon as he knew that he belonged unto Herod's jurisdiction, he sent him to Herod, who himself also was at Jerusalem at that time. So what did he do? He says, let me see if I could get myself out of this situation. I see the truth before me. I find no fault with the truth. But instead of making a decision on the truth, let me leave that decision with someone else. My brothers and sisters, indecisiveness is a curse to the kingdom of God. And that's why we mentioned in 1 Kings chapter 18 and verse 21, when Elijah said, how long halt ye between two opinions? If it be God, serve him. If it's Baal, serve him. In other words, God says, make a choice not to be indecisive. And Pilate's indecisiveness led to is ruin. What is truth, my friends? We've been hearing the truth for the past 3 weeks. Now my question is, will we crucify the truth? Now, indecisiveness is a very dangerous position. Let me share with you another reason why. Go to Acts chapter 24. Acts chapter 24. Let me show you the danger of indecisiveness. Acts chapter 24. And I want you to notice how dangerous indecisiveness is. Acts chapter 24. Now, this is Felix. And the Bible says in Acts chapter 24 and verse 24. And after certain days, when Felix came with his wife Drusilla, which was a Jewess, he sent for Paul and heard him concerning the faith of Christ. And as he reasoned of righteousness, Paul, his reason of righteousness, truth, temperance, truth, and judgment to come, truth, Felix trembled and answered, go thy way for this time. When I have a convenient season, I'll call for thee. You get that, my friends? Felix was presented with the truth. And instead of making a choice, he says, Paul, I hear it, and I'm not disagreeing with it, but, listen, when there's a convenient season, I will call for thee. When you read further and get more details, you find out that Felix stole Drusilla from her husband, and he was living in an adulterous relationship. And when Paul confronted on it and reasoned of him with righteousness, temperance, and judgment to come, he says, Paul, she's too beautiful. I hear the truth, but I wait for a more convenient time. My friends, that convenient time never came. Felix is lost, not just lost, but lost eternally. He lost out on salvation. Why? Because he heard the truth and he rejected the truth. Why? Because one of the commandments that he broke was, thou shalt not commit adultery. In other words, he had the truth of the Ten Commandments. Paul presented to him the truth of Jesus. The Holy Spirit pricked his heart. And he says, not right now, Paul. And as a result of his delay, he's forever lost. Don't delay or procrastinate with truth, my friends. All right. Now, let me tell you the danger of procrastinate with truth. The Bible says, a little leaven leaveneth the whole lump. There's an old saying that compromise in anything is a threat to compromise in everything. Are you with me? If we allow one thing to be compromised, if we think it's just a small thing that God can't be this particular, I share with you, God is a particular God. What is the big deal about biting a fruit? 6,000 years later, millions and billions of deaths later, we see what was the result of biting a fruit. God is a particular God, my friends. Don't compromise any truth. Now, then he says, in Matthew 27 and verse 24, I wash my hands. I find no fault with the truth. He washed his hands. He said, I find no fault with the truth. But he did not decide on the truth. Now, notice what this says. These hidden away, secret sins form character. The law of God condemns not only what we have done, but we have not done. In other words, he's saying, I'm going to let you guys do what you're going to do, but I'm going to tell you, this is not me. I'm washing my hands. He had the opportunity to decide for the truth, my brothers and sisters. He had the power to say, look, this man is innocent, and I'm going to let him go. But what did he say? I'm washing my hands, but you can go ahead and kill him anyway. It's not just about doing what's right. It's not just about avoiding what's wrong, because there's a sin of commission and there's a sin of omission. In other words, if there's certain things that we know that we should do and we don't do it, the Bible says that it's still sin. Pilate had the opportunity to free Christ, but what did he do? He compromised. Say, I wash my hands. I'm free from this man's blood. Is he? No, my friend. The hidden away, secret sins form character. The law of God condemns not only what we have done, but what we have not done. We will, in the day of final account, find a register of the sins of omission as well as the sins of commission. In other words, God says, in the record books, in the book of iniquity, there's two kinds of sins that's marked. The sins of what we committed, and also the sins of the things that we should have done that we did not do. Pilate's record would be, you should have freed Jesus because you found no fault with him, but you omitted to do the right thing. Therefore, you are omitted from the book of life. You're omitted from the book of remembrance, and your name only remains in a book of iniquity, my friends. It is a dangerous thing to not decide on the truth. God will bring every work into judgment with every secret thing. It is not enough that it's not enough that by your own measurements of character, you prove you have done no positive wrong. The fact that one has done no positive good will be enough to condemn him as a wicked and slothful servant. In other words, if you're faced with a position where you should do the right thing, he says, well, I'm not going to do anything. God says you are just as guilty as if you committed a wicked act, my friends. What is truth today? The Word of God is truth. We've heard it. The law of God is truth. We've spent time speaking about the law of God. The sanctuary is the truth. We've talked about the sanctuary. The Spirit is truth. We prayed and asked for the Spirit's guidance. Jesus is the way and the truth. We've talked about Jesus. My question is, what will we do with the truth, my friends? And I pray we don't do what Pilate do. So the question is, what should we do with the truth? Is that a good question, my friends? Let's find out from the Bible what we should do with the truth. Psalm 86. Book of Psalms, chapter 86. What should we do with the truth? Psalms 86 and verse 11. Notice what the Bible says. This is beautiful. What should we do with the truth? Psalm 86. And notice what the Bible says in Psalm 86 and verse 11. The Bible says, teach me thy way, O Lord. Oh, this is beautiful, my friends. Teach me thy way, O Lord. Have we taught the way of God, my friends? We just studied today that God's way is in the sanctuary. We taught the way of God. Everything is wrapped up in the sanctuary. What does it say? Teach me thy way, O Lord. I will walk in thy truth. God says today, my friends, you've heard the truth. Walk in the truth. What should we do? Walk in the truth. Now the question is this, how do we do this? How do we do this? What are some ways that we walk in the truth? What are some things that we do to take that step to get to the truth? Go with me to Mark chapter 16. Mark chapter 16, and notice what the Bible says in Mark chapter 16 and verse 16. Mark 16, verse 16. Notice what the Bible says in Mark 16 and verse 16. The Bible says, he that believeth, and there's a connecting word there, is not just enough to believe. He that believeth and is baptized shall be saved. But he that believeth not shall be damned. God says, if you believe the truth, if you love the truth, if you want to walk in the truth, demonstrate it. How? By making a decision and being baptized. He that believeth and is baptized, the same shall be saved. Now, the question, my friends, is what hinders? Is it earthly possessions? God talked about that. Gave the parable. Is it the job? God talked about that. Is it earthly relationships? Is it a husband? Is it a wife? Is it the children? God talked about that. And God is taking away step by step every excuse for hindering and not making a right choice about giving your heart fully to Jesus. Whenever you married your husband or your wife, you're simply sealing the fact that you want an eternal relationship. God says, if you want to seal the fact that you have received the truth and you want to make an eternal relationship with me, I want you to demonstrate how? By being baptized. He that believeth and is baptized, the same shall be saved. Now, my question is, what hinders us? Notice what the Bible says in the book of Acts. Acts chapter 8. Acts chapter 8, notice what the Bible says. Acts chapter 8. And notice what the Bible says in the book of Acts, chapter 8, verse 35 through 39. Acts 8, 35 through 39. The Bible says, then Philip opened his mouth and began at the same scripture and preached unto him who? The truth, Jesus, my friends. And as they went out their way, they came unto a certain water, and the eunuch said, see, here is water. What doth hinder me to be what, saints? Baptized. In other words, he says, Philip, I heard the truth. And I don't want to wait. I don't want to delay. I don't want time to pass. I see the water. What hinders me? I want to walk in the truth. I see the water. What hindereth me, Philip? And Philip saith, if thou believest with all thine heart, thou mayest. He answered and said, I believe that Jesus Christ is the Son of God. In other words, I believe the truth. And he commanded the chariot to stand still. And they went down both into the water, both Philip and the eunuch, and he baptized him. Praise God, my friends. And then, once Philip's work was done, then God took him away. Next week, my work will be done. God is going to take me somewhere else. But I want to see what Philip saw. I want to see that there's some people that have made a choice to accept the truth and say, Lord, I'm going to share publicly that I'm going to switch sides. I believe, and Lord, I want to be baptized. Now, what if I'm already baptized? Go to Acts chapter 19. Notice what the Bible says in Acts chapter 19, verse 2. Acts chapter 19 and verse 2. The Bible says in Acts chapter 19, verse 2, he said unto them, have ye received the Holy Ghost since ye believed? Many of us were baptized, but we are told that we were buried alive, my friends. When a person is baptized, the Bible says in the book of Romans chapter 6, when we go down, we are signifying that we have laid aside the old life and we are coming up a new creature. And how does this happen? When the Holy Spirit takes hold of our hearts, he convicts us of truth. He allows us to walk in truth, and we see the errors of our way, and we say, Lord, I'm going to follow in your way. So Paul said to them, you are baptized, but have you received the Holy Spirit? Were you buried alive? What was the response? And they said unto him, we have not so much as heard, whether there be any Holy Ghost. Verse 3, and he said unto them, unto what then were you baptized? And they said, unto John's baptism. And then said Paul, John verily baptized the baptism of repentance, saying unto the people, that they should believe on him, which should come after him, that is, on Christ. Verse 5. When they heard this, what happened, saints? They were baptized in the name of the truth, the Lord Jesus Christ. They were baptized, but they might have been buried alive. When else did this take place? Acts chapter 2. Go back to chapter 2. Acts chapter 2. Let's notice what the Bible says in the book of Acts chapter 2. And verse 5, Acts 2, verse 5, and then we're going to jump over to chapter 37. I want to show you who were baptized, who were rebaptized, I should say. Acts chapter 2, the Bible says in Acts chapter 2 and verse 5, and there were dwelling at Jerusalem Jews, devout men of every nation under the sun. So in other words, men that were Christians that came from all around the world. Verse 37, Peter is given a straight message, and they've never heard it like that before. Then the Bible says, now when they heard this, they were pricked in their hearts. These devout men from all around the world, pricked in their hearts, and said unto Peter and to the rest of the apostles, men and brethren, what shall we do? Then Peter said unto them, repent and be what, saints? Baptized. Every one of you devout men, be baptized. I know you were baptized before, but you did not receive the truth. So every one of you, be baptized again. Devout men. Every one of you, in the name of Jesus, the truth, for the remission of sins. And that you shall receive the gift of the Holy Ghost, the truth, for the promise which is unto you. And to your children, and to all that are far off, even as many as the Lord our God shall call. And with many other words did he testify and exhort, saying, save yourselves from this untoward generation. Verse 41. Then they that gladly receive his word, the word of what? The word of truth, were baptized, and the same day there were added unto them about 3,000 souls, and that's beside women and children, my friends. Devout men heard the word of God, received the truth of Jesus, received the truth of the word, received the truth of the Holy Spirit, and they said, we have never heard it on this light. And what happened? They saw that they were never living up to the full light of God, so the Bible said they were baptized again, 3,000 devout men. Praise God, my brothers and sisters. Now, there's a story of a man that was living, I believe it was some kind of Muslim nation. And of course, it was illegal to become a Christian in those nations. And when he was going to the court after he was just baptized, they said, "I heard that you were just baptized and became a Christian. I'm going to ask you to recant and take it back." Man says, "I have submitted all to Jesus, and I would not recant." Then he said, "Do you know who you're talking to?" He says, "Do you understand the ramifications?" He says, "If you do not recant, I'll take away your house and your possessions." That man says, "I have no house. I have no possessions. I've given it all to Jesus." Then he said, "All right, smart aleck. You keep talking like that. You know what we're going to do? We'll kill your wife and we'll kill your children." He said, "I have no children. I have no wife." Why? "Because I gave them to Jesus." Then he says, "All right, you keep talking like that. Do you understand that you're captured right now?" He says, "If you keep it up, we will take your life." He said, "I have no life." Why? "Because I gave it to Jesus." The song says, "Give it all, give it all, give it all to Jesus." Bible says, "Don't fear them that can give you temporary death. But fear Jesus, my friends. Because Jesus alone can give you what? Eternal life. If they took his life, he'd have received eternal life." You know what they said? They said, "This man has lost his mind. Let him go." Praise God. He took his stand and says, "I'm giving it all to Jesus." And that very day, he received freedom. Now, when Christ died, there were three crosses. And we're closing. There were three crosses. Jesus was on that central cross. Jesus died on the cross that Barabbas was supposed to die on. Jesus was surrounded by two thieves, equal position to Christ. Both thieves began to mock Christ. Both thieves began to laugh at Christ. Both thieves mocking with the people and reviled against him and saying, "Save thyself." Then when you read on in Luke chapter 23, the Bible says one of the thieves, one of the malefactors, were mocking Christ. And the other malefactor that was mocking Christ before, you know what he did? He said, "Leave this man alone. This man is an innocent man, and we are guilty." Something happened in that thief's life, and his life was transformed. My friends, I trust that we will see or be in the presence of Jesus, the truth, and our hearts will also be transformed. Now, what happened? On that cross, so three crosses, one died to sin. That thief that was mocking Christ just a few hours earlier saw the spotless life of God. He saw the same thing Pilate saw, but he got a different result. He saw the same thing that thief that was in the exact proximity saw. He heard the same things, but he got something different. He said, "This man is no ordinary man. This man had the power to get rid of sin in my life." And he says, "Lord, remember me when thou comest in thy kingdom. Lord, help me to be overcome all the sins that I've ever done. Lord, please forgive me of everything that I've done." And God says, "Yes, I'll do it." And that thief died to sin that very moment, and he'll be saved eternally, my friends, in a moment. In a moment right now, we can make a choice for Jesus, and we can be saved. One died for sin, that central cross, Jesus Christ, he died for sinners so that we can die to sin. But unfortunately, one died in sin, eternally lost, And I can imagine. When that thief arise that died in sin, when he's woken in a second resurrection, he's going to look through that Jerusalem, that wall of glass. He's going to see his friend that robbed with him. He's going to see his friend that murdered with him. He's going to see his friends that stole with him. As he's looking, he's going to see this friend in illustrious joy with Jesus and with the saints on high, talking to David and talking to Moses and talking to Elijah and talking to Enoch. And he's going to be looking at it and say, I had the same opportunity that he had. And the tears begin to trickle down his eye and saying, why did I not make the same choice that he made at that very moment? And then he bows down his knees and says, Lord Jesus, you are King of Kings and Lord of Lords, but my friends, it will be too late. He's going to say, why didn't I make that choice at that moment? I lived a life of frivolity and revelry, and at that moment, just like my good friend who I stole and robbed with, I see him enjoying the eternal bliss, and I'm eternally lost. And the Bible says, and fire came down from God out of heaven and devoured him. What was the difference? The difference was the choice that he made at the time. One died to sin, one died in sin, and they could have looked upon the one who died for sin, my friends, and he could have been saved just like his friend. One died a forgiven sinner. One died a savior from sin. One died a condemned sinner. One was almost persuaded. Almost persuaded. Now, there's a song that our song leaders are going to sing for us. And I want you to listen to the words of this song. Very powerful. I want you to meditate upon these words and pray earnestly in your heart as you listen to these words of this song. The song is entitled, Almost Persuaded. Acts chapter 26, Paul is standing before a man by the name of Agrippa, a king. He's also standing beside a man named Festus. And Paul poured his heart out in a message. And watch what was their response in verse 24. Acts 26, verse 24, the Bible says, and as he thus spake for himself, Festus said unto, with a loud voice, Paul, thou art beside thyself. Much learning doth make thee mad. Now watch what Paul says in verse 25. Paul says, I am not mad, most noble Festus, but speak forth the words of truth. Paul says, I've not lost my mind. What I've done is I've told you guys the truth. Then Paul addressed the king. For the king know these things. He's heard about these things. The king, you know these things. Before I speak freely. For I'm persuaded that none of these things are hidden from him. For this thing was not done in a corner. King Agrippa, believest thou the prophets? I know thou believest. Paul says, you heard the truth. And king, I know you believe. But unfortunately, the Bible says in verse 28. Then Agrippa said unto Paul, almost, thou persuadest me to be a Christian. After he heard the truth, says Paul, that was a powerful message. Yes, you spoke the truth. Almost, you persuadeth me to be a Christian. Agrippa, just like Felix, is forever lost, my friends. Why? Because he was not almost, well, he was not fully persuaded, but he was almost persuaded. Now let me say this. Almost, but not wholly persuaded, means almost, but not wholly lost. If you're not fully persuaded for the truth, you're fully persuaded against the truth. Because he was not fully persuaded, he was fully lost. What did Paul say? King Agrippa, I wish that you would not only be almost, but wholly persuaded for God. My desire for us, my friends, is that we're not almost, but wholly persuaded. What is truth? The word is truth. The law is the truth. The sanctuary is the truth. The spirit is the truth. Jesus is the truth. I trust that you're fully persuaded and not almost persuaded. Let's listen to the next stanza.
Almost persuaded.
This time I'm going to ask our ushers to come forth with the cards. Now, once we receive the cards, I want us to put our names, our address, and our phone numbers on these cards. Now, once you receive the card, I want us to listen to the last words of this song. These are the words that we're trying to avoid. Sad words. And I'd pray and plead and trust that none of us will be the fulfillment of the third stanza, but that we'll not just be almost, but wholly persuaded to be on God's side.
Almost persuaded.
Bye.
If you have the card in your hand, you've already pulled out your name, your address, and your phone number. Our sermon topic this afternoon was, what is truth? The first item says, I accept Jesus Christ as my personal Savior. If you accept Jesus Christ as your personal Savior, go ahead and check that first box. The second one says, the information presented was not clear and I need further information. If you need further clarity, let me know. Go ahead and check that box. The third box says, it is my desire to keep God's seven-day Sabbath and all His truths. The truth of the Word, truth of the sanctuary, truth of Christ, the truth of the Holy Spirit, the truth of Jesus. I desire to keep the seventh-day commandment and all His truth. Go ahead and check that box. Now, if God has spoken to us, my friends, and we desire to be baptized or desire to be rebaptized, go ahead and check that box. And by the way, we're not going to rush anyone into the pool. We want to make sure that you study, you understand, and most importantly, you've accepted the thing. So we will have a baptism next week for those who are ready. For those who are not ready, we'll continue to study with you, and we'll plan a baptism for a further date. But go ahead and at least make the choice. Today, when you hear His voice, harden not your hearts. Make the choice today, my friends. How long halt ye between two opinions? If God be God, serve Him. If Baal, serve him. And lastly, I'm requesting a personal visit. If you need a personal visit from me specifically, go ahead and check the evangelists on the card. Now, if you're requesting prayer, you could go ahead and write your prayer request on a card as well. We pray over all of the prayer requests that we receive on these cards. We call them by name. Amen? Now, at this moment, we're going to ask the ushers to come back and pass your cards to the center aisle. Let's go ahead and pass them to the center. Our ushers will come and collect those cards. Again, we have supper available for you now. And when is our next meeting? What day and time? Talk to me. Thursday, what time? 6 o'clock supper. And what time do we start the meeting? 6:30. When is our next one after that? Friday, what time? 6 o'clock supper and 6:30 meeting. What's the next one after that? Sabbath. 10:45, 3 p.m., and 4:30 p.m. And let me just give you a preview of our subjects for next week. Next week, we'll look at the mark of the beast. The mark of the beast. We'll also look at a subject entitled homework. We all need some homework, amen? So we're going to look at Bible prophecy and last day families. Does God have a specific plan and specific purpose for last day families? Yes. Then we look at God's last day church. God has raised up a specific church in a specific time for a specific work. We'll look at that. We'll also look at a message entitled Almost. And then we'll look at the Scarlet Harlot and the U.S. in prophecy. The Scarlet Harlot and the U.S. in prophecy. Have we been blessed? Have we learned? And praise God, we pray that it's not just information, but transformation. So I'm going to invite you to kneel with me as we close out in prayer. Father, thank you so much for what we've learned. Thank you for the truth, Lord. And I pray that as Psalm 86 and verse 11 says, that we will walk in the truth. And I pray your blessings upon us now, Lord. Be with us throughout the rest of this, your holy day. Bless us and grant us traveling mercies that we take go to our various destinations. Bless the food that have been prepared. May your Holy Spirit be in our hearts and continually convict us of these truths and help us to walk in these truths as we're told that the Holy Spirit leads us and guides us into all truth. We thank you for your mercies, Lord. Thank you for your words. That we can study freely now in a time of peace. There comes a time that we can only study in a time of storm. So I pray that we'll take advantage of the freedom and opportunities that we have now to study. We love you, Lord, and we thank you. These things we ask and pray for in the precious name of Jesus. Amen. Amen. And let the church say, amen. May God bless you, and we'll see you next Thursday.